So welcome. This is seventh series, the spring series, session one, 2023. This marks 5 years of the foundation now. So we're now in our sixth year. Welcome to all of you. First of all, just to thank those of you that attended the Space Medicine Symposium a couple of weeks ago. It was a fascinating afternoon. And thank you very much for those of you that have written. We had a lot of feedback after that meeting, and the proceedings are close to being ready to be released, and we have decided to put together a working group to put together the recommendations of the type of research that we think is absolutely essential prior to venturing past low Earth orbit, and we'll be back in touch with those of you that have written to us and those that wanted to suggest work programs and suggested experiments. So today, we're going to be looking in this series at, for each of the meetings, we're going to be looking at research and findings from that research of work sponsored by the Foundation. Some of this is a little bit later in coming because of the interruptions from the pandemic, but very welcome all the same. And the speaker today is Dr. Rhys Mould from the University of Westminster. Westminster was our first recipient of a grant back in 2018, I think, or 19. And Rhys is going to talk about the role of biophotonics and electromagnetic fields in cellular communication and bioenergetics. And so, as you know, just before we start, we are recording the session. We'd be grateful if questions can be left to the end. But we won't be recording the Q&A. So without much more ado, I'd like to introduce Alistair Nunn, who, as you all know, is the Director of Science for the Guy Foundation and Visiting Professor at the Research Centre for Optimal Health at the University of Westminster. And with that, Alistair, can I turn the meeting over to you?
Thank you, Geoffrey. Yes, I'm just going to provide a little bit of a background to the foundation and a few thoughts on how we got here and how we might move and how we might be moving forward, just to give a bit of context to where Rhys is going to talk about. As you probably know, we're trying to facilitate research into quantum biology and what it could do for medicine. And how we got here has been quite an interesting path. And the sort of theme that keeps coming out all the time is this need to embrace a kind of a polymath approach to help break down the boundaries between different disciplines. From a personal perspective, this is just how we kind of got here, going back to about 1993. It gives you an idea of where our thinking was. Certainly Jimmy and I used to work together at the Hammersmith many years ago in 1993, and we were looking at sort of the fatty acids, MRI spectroscopy, and I was looking at apoptosis. And meanwhile, at the same time, Geoffrey was, I think, on his way to the first listing on the NASDAQ. And Stan, who came along a bit later, was starting out in Leicester. I then moved into the pharmaceutical industry. And this was actually a real eye-opening exercise for me because I'd spent a lot of time just in academia. And then looking at how the pharmaceutical industry worked gave me a much broader context view. And then in 1998, I moved from the Novartis into what's known as medical communications. And this is a kind of a parallel industry to the pharmaceutical industry. And it's all about medical communications. And one of the roles I had was actually I had to study an awful lot of different diseases and different drugs. And it gave you a very broad view. And one of the things that came out of this when I was doing it was the role of mitochondria in determining health in lifestyle-induced diseases. And of course, Jimmy and I worked on this before, but we got back in contact again, and we started to develop a few ideas around this. And then in 2006, I was made redundant, and it just goes to show how when bad things happen to you, sometimes good things actually come out of it. And I decided to set my own company up. And when I was casting around to find a few clients, I was trying to sell myself as a kind of freelance scientist. My brother, who used to know Geoffrey, said, "Why didn't I contact Geoffrey?" And we did. And it turned out that Geoffrey was very interested in bioenergetics and cannabinoids. And the rest, as they say, was a kind of history. We moved quickly into working on some of these aspects of the project at the Hammersmith Hospital with Jimmy. And in 2014, and this is another sort of pivotal moment, Jimmy moved to Westminster to set up the Research Centre for Optimal Health. I moved to Reading. And by this point, we were, Jeffrey and I were really discussing the idea of what health was, what mitochondrial function was, why it was going on, everything. And the critical point here was we needed to expand a bit and understand a bit more about where these compounds might be going in cells. So we got in contact with this chap called Stan Botchway at Harwell. And this really began to move forward quickly because we then started to try and image these compounds in cells. And this kind of changed the way we view things. And in 2018, Jeffrey helped set up the foundation with which we helped him with. And both Jimmy and Stan at the time became advisors. So really, the scientific path was quite interesting because Jimmy and I were starting off in health and mitochondria. And then when we met Jeffrey, who was also obviously beginning to think in this way, we started to sort of compare notes. And then we discovered this thing called hormesis. Now, this is one of these strange things that happens in science. You can go for years and years and years not knowing about a concept, but this is the biophasic adaptive response to stress. And we started to think, well, are these compounds in plants doing this? Of course, the next big question was, well, if they're doing this, where are they going? And the literature on certainly on the phytocannabinoids, where they go in the cell is very, very limited. So we had this great idea that because we knew they fluoresced, could we follow them through a live cell? And so this is when we approached Stan. And unfortunately, again, the experiment didn't work. And we were trying to work out why, and possibly to do with quenching. But one of the things we did kind of discover, and again, this is nothing new, was the course that the mechanism we were using to study these compounds actually damaged the cells a bit. And it was obviously light-induced damage. When you're thinking, well, this is quite normal, but, you know, why? And then we realised, of course, the cell is full of chromophores. Now, this, again, sounds like something we should have known for a long time, but you don't really appreciate that or think in that way. And of course, the question immediately came is why? And when we realised the electron transport chain is full of these compounds which can absorb and indeed fluoresce, and ranging from the things like NADH and FAD and the flavines and the cytochromes, and certainly some other molecules like phenylalanine and things, we kind of started to think slightly differently. So what does this actually mean? And what were we missing? And again, this is not one of these revolutionary moments. We suddenly went, where else do we need to look? Now, one of the kind of serendipitous areas we've been following was the work of Nick Lane on Origins of Life and Mitochondria. In one of his books, he mentioned this idea that there could be this thing called tunneling going on. And yes, I was a biochemist and it didn't immediately spring to mind. But as soon as we started looking into it, we realized it was this whole world that we hadn't really seen, which involved, quantum mechanics, thermodynamics, and fields. And so, of course, this led us to start thinking straight away, of course, are we missing something here? And of course, as Jeffrey is very, very interested in looking into how we can improve medicine and everything, we started to think about this very differently. And so, and this is when the ideas of the foundation were born. And this is a typical example. I'll just show this as a slight aside, but this is a spectrum of cannabinoid, which fluorescent spectrum. And of course, when you talk about these compounds, most people think about what are the drug targets in the cell. But we started thinking, well, what's its light absorbing properties doing? And when you realize that the compounds, the cannabinoids belong to a much bigger group of plant secondary metabolites, there's over 12,000 phenolic compounds being identified. And as a group, they seem to all be important in acting as sunscreens, which is absorbing light and dissipating it. And as we now know, a lot of them modulate mitochondrial function. So what else do they do? And of course, this led us on to trying to image the cells. And this is one of the very first pictures that Stan helped me take of cells. And this is using two photon emission using NADH. And of course, this is NADH, natural NADH in the cell. And when you get it fluorescing, it shows up in the mitochondria. You know, you kind of think, wow, isn't that amazing? But of course, if we think about why they're doing this, and has it any impact on cell function? Well, the answer is yes, it does. And certainly when we started to look at things like lifetime decay, we could start to see differences. And this this is where sort of Rhys was coming onto the scene. Rhys has been working with Jimmy for some time, and he started getting his head around and doing some very good experiments where we started to study this fluorescence of an NADH and what happens to compounds like cannabidiol. And yes, the answer is yes, it does change the redox in these cells. So what is this light interaction doing? Is it just a spurious finding? Or is it something else? So really, what this taught us in this little episode over the years was that you sometimes have to think again, and there's an awful lot of reinventing the wheel in science. And you know, when we started investigating hormesis, we realized that the ideas of this adaptive response to stress was recognized by the Greeks and the Romans and the Chinese 2,000 to 3,000 years ago. It was called something different, but they, you know, they knew this was a really quite important thing. And then, of course, we spiral forward very quickly to about 200 years ago, and we start looking into bioelectricity. And you go, crikey, these guys were thinking well ahead of their time. And what was interesting about certainly the period around when this was first being looked into was, of course, there was the old battle going on between Volta and Galvani. And of course, one side was the physicist going, oh, electricity is all about physics. And then there was a biologist going, no, it's all about biology. And there's a yin-yang of this going on for many years. But of course, at the same time, we had Wallace and Darwin talking about natural selection. And then we had thermodynamics and steam engines, which led to quantum mechanics in the last 100 years. And a lot of the people involved in the region, involved in developing quantum mechanics, thought about it, you know, from the perspective of biology, so Bohr, Pascal, Jordan, and others. But also around the same time, and we'll come back to this briefly in a minute, is, of course, the biophotons idea. Around this time, everybody was thinking differently. And they said, oh, yeah, well, what's wrong with having electric fields to make shape, or, you know, the morphogenetic idea? And what's wrong with communicating through light? And it kind of got buried for a while. And then, of course, we move on a few years and we get to the ideas of electron transport and possibility that in cells it could be using a quantum process. Then we came, Peter Mitchell developed chemiosmotic theory, again, having to overcome an enormous amount of opposition about how the energy is being produced in the cell. Although, interestingly enough, and Carl knows about this, it might be challenged shortly. We won't go into that now. But then, of course, we move on. Because of that, and this mitochondria became very much a hot topic in that period. Then we have the free radical theory of aging, and that's quite old, and it's come and gone a few times. It's come back again. Then, of course, we come to a slightly left field idea, which, of course, is people started to discover thermal vents in the deep seas. And originally, you know, people didn't really understand what this is all about. But one of the things they discovered quite early was these thermal vents emit light. They glow. I mean, we probably can't see it with the naked eye, but they certainly do glow. And then about 10 years later, people started developing ideas around, well, where does life, you know, is life didn't just develop in a soup, but did it actually develop in an alkaline thermal vent? And so these ideas all began to overturn quite quickly. And there was a descent of the electron idea, bringing more into the quantum realm. And then certainly in the last 20 years, people have started to think, well, can we explain the origins of life using quantum mechanics and thermodynamics? And more recently, the geothermal life explanation is now being used to perhaps suggest that's how photosynthesis started. So really, what's humans have been doing the last 100 years? And I think there's been a lot of reinventing of wheels and starting again. But actually, there's a lot of really good ideas in here. And of course, one of the things that I think everybody who's worked in science realizes that some ideas can slightly make you go down a different direction. Of course, the discovery of DNA and genetics, and some degree the linear response in pharmacology had an effect of taking us away from some of this. But I think we've now got a fantastic opportunity, and as a collection, to start thinking in different ways. And how do we change the hypothesis into a grand unified theory? Kind of what we're seeing in the literature, and a lot of folk ahead of us and have been talking about this idea that potentially life is using a photonic homeostatic system. Of course, could it be also using the electromagnetic homeostatic system? I mean, because life is all about movement of charged particles. You know, every membrane has a charge across it. It means electrons, protons, and ions are moving all the time. Then you throw in the idea that life is a dissipative system. You can put all these things together. Can we use this idea to develop something which we can provide a new grand unified theory in biology, which integrates all of these ideas? So you've probably seen some of these before. This is the idea where we look at some of the main some of the most difficult questions in biology. You know, what's the origins of life, which is consciousness, what's aging, even what is inflammation? We're not entirely sure, but there's, you know, how do we use this in medicine? Of course, there's this idea that for all these years, we've just been looking at chemicals, but the yin and yang of that, we need to look at fields. And of course, this is the idea of the negative entropy, life being a form of negative entropy. So what are these things, how are these things all linked together? Now, of course, that brought us up to 2018, because beyond then now, we've been very, very lucky to get involved with everybody in the field. And we've got some great projects on the way with Wayne, Wayne Frasch, Philip Curian, and Mike Levine. But within the community, of course, we've had all of these folk, and I won't go through everybody, but these are all the people we've been talking to. And I think we're developing this fantastic community. And I think this is a lot of what the foundation is about. You know, we've come from this idea in the past to this new idea. And I think hopefully when we get all these people together, we can start to really make things happen. And I just go through, these are the projects that we've gone through. And you can see that we've been developing these ideas for quite a long time. We're starting with the old phytocannabinoids and the mitochondrial function, to 2018, when the foundation was formed, and the first kind of funded research, which is what Rhys is going to talk about. But we've been going from strength to strength since there. So the key here is we have to prove a lot of this stuff, and we need to repeat and confirm. And, you know, for instance, can cells and mitochondria communicate non-chemically? These ideas have been around a long time. There's a lot of very good science done, but we need to make this, get it to a critical level. Is this non-chemical connection? Is it photonic or electromagnetic or both? We need the repeatable data to raise awareness and bring this field back on into a really good place, and of course help to raise cash. And what does this mean for aging in medicine? And we're back to the same question. Does it explain how phytocannabinoids are working? Well, we have some ideas, but not today. So today's talk, so it's from Whistle Top Stew. Of course, we're today Rhys is going to talk about these things. And of course, it's 100 years since Gurwitsch's famous onion experiment. I think most of you are familiar with that now. He cut the roots of an onion. Somehow it communicated to another onion root that to undergo mitosis. And I'll just finish before we hand you over to Rhys to remind you, and Nina's asked me to remind you about this. This is we have this little prize available called the Guy Foundation Onion Prize, which celebrates Gurwitsch's work. With that, I shall hand over to Rhys.
Thank you, Alistair, for the setup. My name is Rhys Mould. I'm a postdoc at the Research Centre for Optimal Health based at the University of Westminster. And today I'm going to talk to you about, the name of the presentation is the role of biophotonics in cellular communications and bioenergetics and modulation by natural products. And as mentioned, the title of the work was derived from the title of the grant, the first, I believe, awarded by the Gaia Foundation in 2018. The role of biophotonics and electromagnetic fields in cellular communications and bioenergetics and modulation by natural products. And this is written by Professors Bell, Botchway, and Nunn, who you just heard from. So to give some structure, I'm going to go through a brief introduction as to what we're going to talk about, some of the compelling history behind biophotonic research, how biophotons integrate with quantum biology, and some of the potential applications of biophotons. I've also, in these slides, I'm experimenting with QR codes. So if I mention a paper, I'll include the QR code. So if you scan that with your phone camera, it should give you an instant link to the publication I'm talking about. Okay, let's begin. So cells and organelles continually emit very low intensity light. And this is what we know as biophotons. Formerly, we would call it ultraweak photon emission, or UPE. But over the course of the last 100 years, I suppose, it's been known by many names, including mitogenic radiation, biological autoluminescence, and ultraweak chemiluminescence. The term biophotons may be considered a little bit contentious, but we'll come back to why later. It's also the catchiest and most memorable way to refer to them, so I'm going to stick with that for the purposes of this presentation. And we would also make an important distinction straight away that these are separate from the processes of delayed luminescence and bioluminescence, with delayed luminescence referring to like a long afterglow of an object after it's been exposed to light. And as we know, bioluminescence chiefly refers to the enzymatic-based light emission that we see in bioluminescent algae in the picture, for example. So biophotons are produced from interactions between reactive oxygen species, ROS, and nearby biomolecules. ROS are chiefly produced from the mitochondria as a byproduct of oxidative phosphorylation. So we consider the mitochondria as a primary source of biophotons. So you can see here in the diagram the production of ROS can either interact with nearby lipids to produce excited carbonyl species. And when those species relax to their ground state, they release a photon of light. Or alternatively, you can have the production of singular oxygen, which again, when it's relaxed into its ground state, also produces a photon. So, and these photons have been detected, up in brackets, we'll come back to why later, between 200 and 800 nanometers, so across the UV and near infrared section of the spectrum. We're looking at extremely low intensities, so 1 to 1,000 photons per centimeter squared per second. To put that in some context, bioluminescence, as we saw in the picture previously, is around 10 to the 5 to 10 to the 10 photons per centimeter squared per second. with the limit of human vision being somewhere between that at 10 to the 7 photons per centimeter per second. And the almighty sun produces a whopping 10 to the 13 to 10 to the 20 photons per centimeter squared per second. So in conclusion, they're extremely low intensity. So what we're trying to break any field down, any field of research into three basic questions: what are the nature of these biophotons and what are their potential roles and how can we exploit them into applications? What we're trying to focus on here at Westminster is what are the roles of biophotons? Are they a way of a cell to dissipate potentially harmful energy, or may they facilitate a form of distant non-chemical communication between cells and organelles? So the interaction between light and cells is exactly a novel idea. We know that cells are packed with chromophores that can interact with light across the UV to visible spectrum. And this forms a basis of photobiomodulation, which we've heard about previously in the foundation from Margaret Ahmed and Michael Hamblin. In particular, we've been looking at red and near-infrared light. And one of the side projects, I guess we can call it, is been looking at the interaction between this light in this region and the mitochondria. So collaborating with Margaret Ahmed in Paris-Sorbonne, we've been looking at the effect of near-infrared light on mitochondrial function. We have a small 734 peak nanometer LED. We expose MCF7 cells, which are a cancerous cell line, and MCF10A, a non-cancerous cell line, to the LED for 20 minutes, and then measure various markers of mitochondrial function immediately after. So we're looking at mitochondrial membrane potential, mitochondrial ROS, calcium levels. And what we found is that immediately after the exposure to the LED, we see significant increases in mitochondrial ROS and changes in membrane potential in a variety of the cell lines. So it's, it has a near instant effect, which I find quite fascinating. And we're going to follow this up, looking into more detailed aspects of mitochondrial function. We've also been working with Margaret on looking at near-infrared exposure on mitochondrial function in an inflammation model. So let's go back to biophotons and their role, particularly as a means of distant non-chemical communication between cells and organelles. So as we've heard, the publications or the idea of non-chemical communications attributed to biophotons stretches back 100 years. I've dug this up from PubMed showing that after the initial discovery by Gurwitsch in 1923, the research really fell off a very steep cliff. There's a few reasons behind that, including like World War II and like the emerging biochemical juggernaut that was associated with that time. In 1984, the coin biophotons was the term biophotons was coined by a guy called Fritz Albert Popp. We're going to come back to him a bit later, but you can also see how it's really exploded in the last, particularly with UPE, has really exploded in the last 10 years. I'm going to take us through a short historical tour on the biophotonic research, which really sets us up for what we're trying to accomplish within this grant. It's also, I find, very fascinating because it consists of a lot of simple yet elegant experimental design, which you don't really see in biochemistry lab these days. So let's start with the father of biophotons, Alexander Gurwitsch, 1923, and his famous onion root experiment that Alistair alluded to a while ago. In the experiment, the onion root tips, not whole onions, but it was easier to illustrate. And onion root tip divided by a quartz barrier was able to influence the rate of mitosis in a nearby recipient onion root. The effect persisted if the barrier was quartz, but disappeared if the barrier was glass or is it fully opaque. So he concluded that there was some sort of non-chemical impulse from the emitter increasing the rate of mitosis in the recipient. And he concluded that this non-chemical impulse must be low-intensity UV. At this point, as I mentioned in the previous slide, the research dropped off, despite Gurwitsch winning multiple prizes for this his work on mitogenic radiation. But really, the research was kind of squashed by World War II and then shut behind the Iron Curtain. So if we move on, jump forward to 1980, and this guy Kazinchi published distant intracellular electromagnetic interaction between two tissue cultures. In these experiments, Kazinchi divided two populations of cells behind a quartz or glass divider. He infected one of the populations with a variety of viruses with magnesium chloride. And after 2 to 4 days, he found that formerly healthy cells now mirrored the morphology of the infected or poison cells, but only when, again, when that barrier was quartz. And he called this a mirror cytopathic effect. I think it's interesting to note that Kazinchi and his team conducted over 1,500 experiments like this, which sounds like a huge amount of work. And it's also important to point out that in the cells, in the formerly healthy cells that were mirrored the virus-infected cells, the healthy cells showed no trace of the virus in their culture. 4 years into close to the present day, we have one of my favorites, distant optical interaction of mitochondria through quartz by Batyanov. In these experiments, Batyanov had isolated rat mitochondria divided into two populations, separate quartz cuvettes. When you add it, and in the outer cell, he was measuring the oxygen consumption using a Clark electrode. When he added the outer cell into the inner cell, he immediately saw a change in the rate of oxygen consumption in the outer cell. And additionally, when he treated succinate, or sorry, treated the inner cell with succinate or ADP, he also found that the rate of oxygen change mirrored that. He found that the rate of oxygen change changed in the outer cell as well, suggesting that there was some sort of signal from the mitochondria affecting the bioenergetics of the outer cell. In 92, we have this one, a rudimentary form of cellular vision by Albrecht Bühler. In these experiments, Bühler seeded two populations of cells on either side of a thin glass film. One, the confluent cells in purple, and sparse cell population in orange. And what he found after a short while is that the sparsity cells rearranged themselves transverse to the confluent cells. And again, this is not observed when the cells are separated by something opaque, such as a thin metallic film. And he proposed that there's some sort of electromagnetic signal, possibly within the red to infrared range. So are these effects always biophotons? So yes, it's still history, but in 2021, we have this paper by Polipovich and Kusyuk, cell-cell death communication by signals passing through non-aqueous environments. In their paper, the authors seeded on a 96-well plate a variety of cell lines. The central row of the column of cells, which is indicated in orange, was treated with some cytotoxic drug. In their case, it was duroquinone. And he measured the change in viability in the cells adjacent to it in columns 5 and 7, which he called the detectors. What they found in 3 of the 4 cell lines they tested is that there was a significant decrease in viability in the detector cells that received no treatment. And they attributed this to biophotons. The paper stood out to me because of the enormous effect size observed and the consequences of the results. If you think about how many labs are doing cytotoxic assays, and how we're saying that in this paper that your cells can undergo an enormous amount of cell death just by virtue of being next to cells that have been treated, that could change like how we think about, or you know, how we are meant to design, or the implications of the implications on the conclusions of many cytotoxic studies. And because this experiment was relatively straightforward, I set out to replicate their work, mostly in MCF7. So in our paper and review that was published last year, I initially was able to replicate their findings. So I treated the inductor cells, the central ones, with duroquinone, and I found in the detector cells that were untreated a significant decrease in cell viability. So replicating their findings. When I probed further, I tried a different drug. I tried cisplatin. But in this case, I was unable to replicate. There was no significant difference in detect cell viability compared to its control. Which was quite curious. Both of these drugs induce apoptosis and they induce huge increases in ROS. The only thing that was mainly different was the solvents they were prepared in. Duroquinones prepared in ethanol and cisplatins prepared in DMF. So I thought I would just swap around the solvents in which the two drugs were prepared in. And lo and behold, when duroquinones dissolve in DMF, you now lose that detector cell viability decrease. There's no change. And when you put cisplatin in ethanol, you get it back. Now the cisplatin, which didn't show the effect before, has now shown a significant decrease in detector cell viability. Now, one of the differences between the two solvents is one's more solvent, much more volatile than the other. So ethanol is much more volatile than DMF. So one of our conclusions was that it was potentially some sort of volatile communication occurring between the wells rather than biophotonic signaling. And we are going to follow this up with some MSE projects in the summer. And so this paper sort of illustrates a significant problem with biophotonic research. With the older publications, they lack the sort of methodical rigor in terms of their controls. Experimental design, as we just saw previously, often fails to control for other factors. But perhaps most importantly, rarely, if ever, do these studies show direct evidence for biophotons. So that brings us on to what we're trying to do here at Westminster and in Harwell. So we're looking at the role of biophotonics in cellular communications and bioenergetics. So we're trying to re-examine this potential biophotonic-based non-chemical signaling with a general aim to replicate past NCC experiments with a greater control and statistical rigor as informed by past critiques and reviews in the field. If we can establish some sort of NCC effect, we're going to proceed to move on to detection and characterization of biophotons from the biomaterial we used in our experiments. So to start with, can biophotons from cells in oxidative stress affect the bioenergetics of cells in the bioenergetics of distant chemically isolated cells? So a super straightforward experiment, we cultured and expanded MCF7 cells and MCF10A cells, which are cancerous and non-cancerous cell lines respectively. And we created this custom non-chemical communication assay. In the assay, we divided the cells into three cuvettes. Each cuvette is capped and contains a magnetic stirrer bar, and each cuvette contains an oxygen probe. The treated cell receives an injection of antimyosin, inducing a significant increase in ROS production. The shielded cuvette is separated from the treated one by an opaque barrier. And the shielded one is closest possible to the treated one. Each of these cuvettes are made out of quartz. So we measured a baseline oxygen consumption for the first 2 minutes, injected antimyosin into the central treated cuvette, and then measured the response in all three cuvettes. And our general hypothesis is that if there was biophoton emission from the treated cuvette, we would see a change in the bioenergetics in the unshielded cuvette, which would be absent in the shielded cuvette. So a super straightforward experiment. This is what a raw data output looks like. So the line represents the mean oxygen or dissolved oxygen over time, and its shaded area is the standard error. To analyze the slopes, we used a mixed linear effects model, which tells us if there's a significant difference in the slope of the two lines and also corrects for any time-based confusion with linear regressions. And we present this as a simple bar chart. So in the case of these MCF7 cells, we found there was no significant difference between the shielded and unshielded cells. So we concluded that there was no evidence for any biophoton-mediated NCC effect between ourselves. But now we considered, what about in mitochondria, the source of biophotons? And we'd already seen this work with Batlinov in 1984. So while there's no evidence for NCC in whole cells, we asked ourselves, can biophotons from isolated mitochondria undergoing oxidative stress affect the bioenergetics of distant chemically isolated mitochondria? So the methodology was largely the same. we cultured and expanded because you needed a heap of cells to isolate enough mitochondria from. We also looked at detecting mitochondrial rust from these samples in response to anti-myosin, which doubled as a sort of quality control to make sure we had viable mitochondria that we'd isolated. And then we also did the non-chemical communication assay, which follows the same methodology as previous, except the mitochondria replaces the cells in each of the cuvettes. The hypothesis remains the same. If there's biophotonic emission from the central treated cuvette, we'll see a change in the unshielded response, or a significant difference between the unshielded response compared to the shielded response. So the first thing to do is check that we had mitochondrial ROS emission from our isolated mitochondria in response to anti-myosin, and we found a significant increase. So confirming that there was indeed ROS production from our isolated mitochondria. And so what we did when we moved forward to the non-chemical communication assay is we now found there was a significant difference between the rate of oxygen consumption between the shielded and unshielded. We found the same thing in MCF10A, our non-cancerous cell line. We also found there was a difference between the responses to cell line, suggesting some sort of that there's a difference in the biophotonic emission, perhaps, or in the perception, perhaps, between the two cell lines. So we concluded this is evidence that there is some sort of non-chemical communication assay between these chemically isolated mitochondria. The previous experiments were carried out in what I called ambient conditions, so in whatever light conditions were in the lab that day. That was following the example set by Batyanov in 1984. We also repeated the experiments in a darker environment. So we isolated the experimental setup from light. And we found again that there's a significant difference between the two responses, the same in MCF10A, but there was no difference this time between the two cell line responses. So the conclusions from these experiments is that you can just about see there's a glow. So we have our non-chemical communication assay. We inject that anti-myosin. This causes an increase in ROS and potentially an increase in biophotons, illustrated by the faint glow. And this has an effect on mitochondrial function, despite the mitochondria being separate from each other. And we are trying to, I'm putting together a paper to represent this, which we're going to call non-chemical signaling between isolated mitochondria. So we're going to move on now to some of the critiques about biophotonic research. So our colleague, I don't know if Mikhail Sifra is present on the call today, but produced this paper, Cell-Cell Signaling Through Light, Just to Go to the Chance, which was trying to illustrate the feasibility of this non-chemical communication facilitated by biophotons. So the questions they posed were, can cells generate electromagnetic radiation with specific properties? And we're fairly sure that this is the case. And then the next question is, can cells detect this radiation and decipher the properties of it? And can they detect it over the ambient noise? Their conclusions are that the very weak intensity make it unlikely that light is a viable communication mechanism between cells or organelles. And while it's possible in principle, it would have to utilize some sort of physical mechanism, which are either inapplicable in biology or yet unknown. Now, I bolded the yet unknown because we get some interesting thoughts about that. So what about intracell signaling? The cells don't have to communicate with each other. Maybe they can communicate within or with other parts of the cell. So this image on the left are MCF10A cells, which we'd use. They've been stained with MitoTracker green. And you can see how the mitochondria expand and twist through the cell in these huge dynamic reticulated networks. So in 2014, Tarr and Kuhl suggested that perhaps the properties of these mitochondrial networks can allow light to propagate along them. So you have this feasibility or this possibility that you can have light-based signaling throughout the cell. So in this case, the mitochondria are acting like an optical waveguide. Right, think of it like a fiber optic net mesh, where you have a small signal that starts in one part of the cell and then quickly propagates throughout the cell, thanks to how the mitochondria are arranged. And it's not just the mitochondria that possess the properties to transfer the energy or light throughout the cell. The mitochondrial network is also entwined with the cell's cytoskeleton made up of aromatic residues that can absorb or interact with light. So in the image you on the left, these are MCF7 cells stained with a nuclear stain in blue. The mitochondria are stained with deep red, so they're illustrated red. And then you have tubulin, which has been stained with a tubulin tracker. So, and we're asking, can tubulin act as a fiber optic network for light emitted or for energy derived from mitochondrial ROS? And this is the work of our colleague, I think is present on the call, Philip Curian, and his paper, which I love, is oxidative species induced excitonic transport in tubulin aromatic networks, potential implications for neurodegenerative disease. In this case, biophotons in the UV range are emitted from mitochondrial ROS, and they are absorbed by nearby aromatic structures that comprise tubulin filaments. Because of the way these aromatic structure, aromatic residues are stacked in tubulin, they allow an exciton to propagate throughout the cell and potentially affect function or morphology of the cell, starting off from these humble mitochondria. And in the paper, Philip shows that there's modeling to support that these tubulin polymers can absorb photons via resonance energy transfer. So the idea that there is a coherent excitonic transfer is interesting parallels with the quantum model of photosynthesis, which I think we may agree is one of like the flagship models in quantum biology. In the quantum model of photosynthesis, photons from the sun create an exciton. And this exciton has to reach the reaction center in order for photosynthesis to occur. So the energy transfer was thought mostly to be random, but because photosynthesis operates much more efficiently than this, we come up, or other people came up with the quantum model in which the exciton, facilitated by how the plant arranges its proteins, can allow for a coherent transport. In which the exciton can take simultaneously every single path whilst simultaneously taking the shortest route. So this brings us back to Fritz Albert Popp. And he was one of the people in that book. He started in 1984, who put together biophotons and quantum biology. So Popp said that biophotons originate from a coherent field that governs biological processes. Now, his work is considered controversial, and I'll refer you to again to Mikhail Shifra and his paper, Biophotons, Coherence, and Photocount Statistics. And one of the troubling, one of the reasons his work is considered controversial is because of how the interpretation of his experimental data. So one of the questions posed is, did Popp inadvertently damage the reputation of the field of biophotonic research? In the 80s, Popp's work was translated by a guy called Johann Boswinkel, who was not a scientist. He took the speculative conclusions from Popp's work and ran a million miles with it, twisting his research into the realms of pseudoscience. So this is taken from his website. So they offer this biophotonic therapy, and these exact quotes: if a chaotic pattern of light is detected, the bioontologist, which is a registered trademark, can test it against a counter signal to a particular element to determine whether that information brings the light emission back to a coherent pattern. The Chiron 3.0, which is the name of their machine, receives biophotons from the client with a glass red. Inside the instrument, the body's coherent light is amplified while the chaotic light is inverted and then sent back into the body. Because these two opposite signals neutralize each other, inverting the chaotic light neutralizes the original signal, bringing a relief in the body's chemistry and relief of symptoms to the physical level. So it's pretty wild. But I think whilst this is often amusing to poke fun at these sort of pseudoscientific being ventures, I think this has made our work considerably harder because now we're fighting uphill to prove and disseminate our research in a field that now rife with this sort of pseudo-scientific nonsense. And now, which makes, I think, it makes our the burden of proof that we have to attain much higher, which I suppose also has the unexpected benefit of making our research much more careful and our data much more compelling. So now I'm going to move on to some of the potential applications of biophotons. If we consider that biophotonic emission is proportional to cellular ROS levels, themselves being linked to the cell's metabolic state, can we use the detection of biophotons to visualize or inform as to the physiological state of an organism? So our colleague and PhD student, who is also funded by the Gaia Foundation, Ify Kalambuka, is looking into the relationship between biophotons and cellular senescence. Senescence being a process in which a cell that undergoes sublethal stress can reach a state of permanent cell cycle arrest. Whilst the cell cycle is arrested and the cell no longer proliferates, it has a distinct bioenergetic change. So what we want to know is, can that bioenergetic change manifest in a biophotonic signature, and can this be detected and quantified? So some of the more, this is quite recent, spontaneous ultraweak photon emission is linked to, collagen-induced arthritis. So you can see in the diagram on the left, these guys, Min He et al. In 2017, we're looking at photon emission using a CCD camera from a mouse model. They found that biophoton intensity correlates with metabolites associated with lipid oxidation and inflammation of ROS. So perhaps biophotonic emission can be used as a tool in a diagnosis of these oxidative stress-related disorders. And this is a similar one using a CCD camera looking at human hands, the application of ultraweak photon emission in dermatology. Obviously, because of the biophotonic emission from the skin is much more easy to detect. Perhaps we can use this as a non-invasive tool to monitor oxidative stress in skin. And can this inform the development of skincare treatments, sunscreens, et cetera? One of the big questions that remains, and I know I haven't answered, is what are they detecting? Or what are we looking at with our research? And we're going to move on to this. So the next steps is the detection and characterization of the signal. So what are those CCD studies actually looking at? One of the things that's come across our desk is delayed luminescence, which we referred to earlier, the long-lasting afterglow. Is our effect, which I've shown data for, mediated by biophotons or delayed luminescence? And perhaps delayed luminescence may be more important or functional than we originally thought. These guys, Tian et al. In 2022, said that delayed luminescent emission had strong correlation with mitochondrial morphology, oxygen consumption rate, and mitochondrial membrane potential. I've gotten the QR code for this one. So I don't want to step on the next next seminar in the series too much, but we're working with Dr. Alistair McKenzie and Professor Stan Botchway at STFC Harwell to detect and characterize our emission from our biological samples here at Westminster. So I'd encourage you all to come back on March 15th to listen to Stan and Alistair talk about what they've been doing. So to summarize, we know that biophotons refer to light continually emitted by cells. They may facilitate non-chemical communication between or within cells. NCC has a long spotty past, and more work is needed to establish that biophotons have this role. At Westminster, we have soon to be published for non-chemical communication between isolated mitochondria, which we believe is attributable to biophotons. The optical / excitonic propagation of biophotonic signals can change how we think about intracellular signaling and draws interesting parallels with quantum models of photosynthesis. Can biophotons provide a light-based cellular signature? Can we use this as a marker of senescence? And can we use perhaps as a tool or a non-invasive diagnostic tool for oxidative stress-related disorders? And perhaps most importantly, what are we looking for? And what about this process of delayed luminescence? And as I just mentioned, our next steps to detect and characterize this signal. We've mentioned it earlier. So if you're going to be present at the GRC conference in Galveston, Texas, our colleague Iffy is going to be presenting an oral presentation on Wednesday. I think it's quite late in the afternoon. And I am going to be presenting a poster. They haven't told me when. So make sure you pop by and see us. So thanks to everyone, the Research Centre for Optimal Health and the University of Westminster, Stan and Alistair at Research, Research Complex in Harwell, and of course the Gaia Foundation, who made all of this possible. And thanks very much for listening.